Good evening and welcome to The Journey Home. I'm Marcus Grodi, your host for this program. This is a special edition of The Journey Home. I'm joined tonight, co-host for tonight is good friend Father Jeffrey Steenson.
Good to be with you.
Yeah. Good to have you here. Monsignor, I've had you here a number of times on the program. The reason I've asked Monsignor to join me tonight is this, which is essentially the 24th anniversary of our first Journey Home episode back in 1997. We're going to take some time tonight celebrating our first guest on the Journey Home, who's a good friend of both of us. We had the privilege of knowing Tom Howard. And it's appropriate to focus this program on Tom. He passed away just about a year ago. And I know those will be people watching this program that just hearing that are mm-hmm. going to bring sadness to their life. So yeah. We want to take this time, though, to celebrate how much Tom has meant in our life, the life of men and women that we work with, right?
Very much so, yeah.
An awful lot of people who've been on the Journey Home these last 24 years can look to Tom Howard for lots of things, for the books and his own witness, his own struggle as a convert to the church. But and I would say, from our own experience, spending time with Tom and Loveless, their hospitality.
It's awesome. We used to, you know, in the old days, when I was a seminary student, and we would go to the same parish, Christ Church in South Hamilton, Massachusetts. And my wife and I were part of Tom and Loveless's Bible study that they hosted, which was totally awesome.
Yeah. What we're going to do tonight is we're going to have several clips from previous Journey Home programs, both of Tom and his wife, Loveless, of a number of people who want to talk about how much Tom made a difference in their life, and then a couple of priests who credit Tom for their call to priesthood. We'll look at some of his books. We're going to look at visiting with Tom and Loveless. And then a final word in the program will be Tom talking about how becoming a Catholic drew him closer to Christ. So, but Monsignor, I'm going to throw the question over to you first before we hear Tom's first clip about his own journey of the church. Talk about your early days with Tom. How'd you get to know him? How he became a part of your life?
Well, of course, we happened to be in the same parish, Episcopal parish in Massachusetts, and that church was going through a revival, mainly because of all the evangelicals that were in the area from your old alma mater, yeah. And it was just a very, very exciting place to be. But I probably got to know Tom best for the first time I got to look it up again. I can never remember these dates. It was in May 1977. So I'd just been starting seminary at that point. And I was one of the privileged seminary students allowed to go to something called the Chicago Call, which happened in the Chicago suburbs. And it was evangelicals getting together to try to recover the ancient faith of the church. And Tom was a member of that. It was organized by Bob Weber, a professor at Wheaton College. And we were talking about Peter Gilchrist being a part of that initially. And I don't know if people talk much more about the Chicago Call anymore, but it was an extraordinary experience. And it changed so many lives. And basically gave the evangelical movement in this country depth in terms of...
So many evangelicals were focused on whatever their denomination's history for the last 50 years or 100 years, or maybe going back 200 years.
Yeah.
But this was a rediscovering of the early church fathers and the liturgy and the rituals.
That's right.
And I noticed you said that was 1997. He wrote his maybe most recognized book, Evangelical Is Not a Knot. Not enough, just a couple years later.
That's right, yeah. Because we were all on, Professor Weber used to describe it as evangelicals on the Canterbury Trail.
Yep.
I don't know if you ever heard that expression. So we were all, you know, thinking that that Anglicanism would solve our yearning. So
you all, including Tom at the
yeah,
time,
including
were heading
Tom.
Towards
yeah.
Anglicanism.
Very much
not
so.
Catholic Church, but yeah. Anglicanism. You were, said you were starting seminary in 1977. I started seminary as a second vocation person in 1978, right up the street from you at Gordon
so
Conwell.
You would have been there.
I would have been yeah. at the same time.
Yeah. We never saw you in church there, though, did
well,
we?
Not in the Episcopal Church. I was congregationalist. But the point is that Tom, I didn't know Tom then.
Yeah.
Except that he had written a book about liturgy.
Yeah.
And I happened to find that in the bookstore. And again, that was awakening a congregationalist at the time, which no liturgy at all, no creed, no, to the value of liturgy. The first one in my life that emphasized that was Tom Howard.
Yeah.
So when we began the Journey Home program in 1997, and who would be the first guest on the program? There was a lot of names that come to mind as possible guests, Tom Howard. And so this first little clip is Tom, and I asked him to give us a quick clip of a summary of his journey into the church.
It took 50 years, but I'll give you the short version. Yes, my background lay in what I would consider that wonderful wing of Protestantism, used to be called fundamentalism. Many fundamentalists prefer to be called evangelicals now. That very often confuses Catholics. Basically, it's the same thing. They are Protestants who love the Lord, love the Scripture, love the Church insofar as they have some inkling of what the Church might mean. Mm-hmm. But certainly it was the example of my father and mother in front of the six of us children, which I would say opened up to us the faith and taught us to love the Scripture, to love the Lord, to take spiritual things seriously. And I would, ironically, consider my own pilgrimage to be a straight line. Mm-hmm. Some people would say, my goodness, he's veered way, way off from his fundamentalist roots. But it was fundamentalism that taught me to take the Scripture seriously. And the more I read the Scripture, the more I found myself mm-hmm. skidding toward Rome, you might say, mm-hmm. although I didn't know that. When I was a young man in my 20s, I was received into the Church of England, the Anglican or Episcopal Church, mainly because I loved good church music and beautiful church buildings and beautiful vestments and beautiful liturgy, mm-hmm. and you don't get that in the free church. So I was received into the Church of England, but I had this tremendous undergirding, almost this granite undergirding of the Scripture and of teaching, faithful teaching on the part of my parents that prepared me to move on. And I was an Episcopalian or an Anglican for 25 years and began to read. And I made the mistake of reading Cardinal Newman, yes. particularly his book, The Idea of Development of Christian Doctrine. Everybody, yes. If they've heard of one book by Newman, they know his Apologia, the story of his own life. But this was his book, which you can get in a Penguin paperback, about how Christian doctrine developed organically. The Lord says in the New Testament that the kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed and grows into a tree mm-hmm. big enough for all the birds of heaven to roost in. And a big tree like that doesn't look like a mustard seed. It grows. Mm-hmm. A lot of people think, but how can something so gigantic as the Catholic Church, that just seems so far away from the simplicity of the upper room and those early household meetings, how can that be the same thing? The same way that an oak tree is the same thing as an acorn. Mm-hmm. It's exactly analogous to that, I think. But as an Anglican, I found myself repeating in the Anglican liturgy every Sunday, I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. And that began to get under my skin. Up until then, I had I would have said, well, that's a spiritual reality. The church is nothing but the aggregate number of born-again individuals all over this world who name the name of Jesus Christ, and it has nothing to do with an organization. There is a sense, of course, in which the Catholic Church would agree with at least part of that, namely, yes, there are believers who are not in organic union with the Catholic Church, and yet they are true believers and followers of Jesus Christ. But I found myself more and more unable to answer the question to myself, why am I holding myself at arm's length from this church of the apostles, the fathers, the martyrs, the confessors, the widows, the doctors, and so on. I felt like the kindergartner with his nose pressed to the window looking in at the party. And I also made the very bad mistake of reading the early fathers. Yes. And the trouble with them, Ignatius of Antioch, Polycarp of Smyrna, Clement of Rome, the trouble with those men is I had to take them seriously because they had been taught by Peter and John and Paul. This is square one. And you start reading their letters to the churches, and you find out that the hierarchy is there, the episcopacy is there, and the mass is there. And I thought, my word, if one of these gentlemen popped up out of his coffin and came to visit my scene, he'd say, "What's this?"
Monsignor, a couple things jump out of me, and then I want to hear your reflection on this. But yeah. I want this kind of makes a couple. First of all, this was the first time in my life I ever did live television, the first moment. And I am so grateful that I had as a guest Tom Howard. It's wonderful for him to rewatch this. Second of all, whenever I see Tom, immediately in my mind, I see him as a companion with C.S. Lewis and Tolkien.
Yeah.
But he was always a New Englander, but somehow in my mind, I picture him a Brit, because both his personality.
He loved things English.
The other thing that jumps to me about this program is just, those who watch Journey Home today, the Journey Home, we have a whole hour for somebody to tell their story. In those days, it was crunched into 27 minutes. And so in those 5 minutes,
he does a brilliant.
What a great summary of almost everything we cover in our work and in the Journey Home program.
You know, what jumped out at me about that reflection that Tom gave there was it reminded me of that text from the Second Vatican Council about those elements of holiness that you can find outside the Catholic Church, but they're oriented toward Catholic unity. I mean, that's was basically what he was describing. Was that because he didn't reject anything about his Protestant background. The positive things, he saw them as things that brought him closer and closer to Catholic unity.
He mentioned so many things, early church fathers, Newman's writings, scripture, and we hear those over and over again after all these years on the Journey Home program and in our work with the Coming Home Network as things that open people's hearts.
And I can remember way back, when I was starting at Trinity Evangelical Divinity School, I started reading Newman's essay on the development of doctrine.
Yep.
I had exactly the same reaction that Tom had there. And I remember my supervisor saying, it's not healthy for a Protestant to read this.
Well, Tom, his own journey is a reminder that generally people don't come in alone. There's always relationships. And Tom did not come in alone, but his spouse, Loveless, who you've known much longer.
Yeah, Tom and Loveless are godparents to our second child. So it's a very...
Very close. Yeah. She didn't immediately follow. So why don't we listen now to a short clip of when Loveless Howard had her joined us on the Journey Home program. Well, how was your response to his decision to become Catholic?
Well, I had two responses. First of all, I understood. I was sympathetic. I thought he was right, but I was terrified because I wasn't there. I couldn't just do it to follow him. We hadn't lived our life that way. We were too old for that. And so I was really anxious that we not have this division and separation in our life of too many friends I knew whose husbands, say, weren't Christians, and they were, had a big separation of this important place in their life. I was really scared. We'd been married 19 years at this point, and during that summer, Tom was away quite a bit. And I had lots of time to pray and pour out my heart to God about this. And there was one day that I was praying, and I felt that God put a choice before me. I could either dig in my heels and cling to my fear and live out the whole division that I could see ahead, or I could receive this from God. And that this is the way God would answer my prayers for my husband. Every wife prays for her husband. I think that's partly what we're for. And I did have some things I was looking to God to do, and I chose that way. I mean, it chose itself for me.
With grace.
And with a lot of peace. And then Tom and I spent the next 6 months talking and talking and talking. We left no stone unturned. Sometimes we went too far and wish we could draw back and hadn't said that, but we talked it all through. One day he said to me with tears in his eyes, "I can't bear the thought of being in a different communion from my wife." And that touched my heart deeply to know that there was no antagonism between us about it, but it was still scary. And one Sunday afternoon after one of these conversations, I went up to my room and I sat down at my desk and I realized that I wanted Tom to be able to do this with freedom and with joy, and that he couldn't until I was happy and at peace about it. And again, God gave me the peace. It was a wonderful work of grace. And I went downstairs and was able to say that he had my blessing, as it were, to do this. And we never had a moment's trouble about it. It was an amazing and wonderful experience.
You know, I mean, what a great grace to hear Lovis's own testimony. And, and her witness there is not all that different than that of so many spouses on the journey.
That's right. I mean, she's so gracious in all this. Yeah. And I remember when Tom appeared on your first show, you asked him about this question, and he gave such wise advice. He said, "You mustn't forget that God gave you a primary obligation, your spouse, your marriage." And I just thought that was a beautiful piece of advice, and how they worked their way through this so patiently you know, with love for each other. And it was a joyous ending.
In our work in the Coming Home Network, dealing with clergy and missionaries and others on the journey, this issue happens all the time. When one's a little bit farther along the journey than the other, some aren't on the journey at all.
Yeah.
And one half might have a pile of books they've read, and the other maybe only one. So there becomes an imbalance. There's no set rule. But in many ways, what they went through became a model for our work, in that he was ready to come in.
Yeah.
But he wanted to make sure she was fine with it. And she, in prayer, gave him permission.
She gave him permission. That's
to
right.
move forward. And for how long? 10 years.
10 years.
Before she entered. In fact, I think she entered just maybe 2 years before he appeared on the Journey Home program.
So many people have come in, have had that experience. Yeah. I did too. I was ready to roll. My wife wasn't yet. And I'm so thankful that the people that were giving me spiritual advice in the Catholic Church said, just cool your jets. Come together. And that was such wise advice.
It's funny, in my own journey, I had read so much and almost exact things he talks about, Essay on Development Doctrine by Newman, and then Early Church Fathers and other converts' writings. And I was sharing it with Marilyn, and she was slowly on the journey. But there was one book that was one of the pivotal books that turned her heart around. It was a book called Evangelical Is Not Enough by Tom Howard. And one of the chapters in there, which we'll talk about later, he talks about liturgical versus spontaneous prayer.
Yeah.
We want to move now to recognize that Tom Howard had an influence on so many people, as did The Witness of Loveless, and we're so grateful to that. We're going to see a couple clips now from former Journey Home guests that mention, at least briefly, how much Tom Howard had an influence on their life. We're going to see three clips, first from Steve Ray, second from Gary and Gail Sommers, and then from Ken Craycraft. We'll listen to their gratefulness to Tom Howard.
Thomas Howard had a huge impact. In fact, if you could say one person flipped the light switch, I would have to say it was his book, Evangelical Is Not Enough. So much so that when I wrote my book, Upon This Rock, I dedicated it partly to him. And the background to this dedication and why so is when we, one time my wife said after the end of a Baptist service, I can't listen to that preacher anymore and call it worship. I'm missing something. Al Cresta gave us a copy of Evangelical Is Not Enough. And my wife read that about liturgical worship right after she said, we can't, what is worship? And she said, Steve, this guy, I don't know who he is, but this guy put into words everything I was thinking but didn't know how to say. When I wrote my book, Crossing the Tiber, and it was only still then in a printed little thing that I made, I met him at Steubenville, Franciscan University of Steubenville, in a summer conference he was speaking. And I went up to him afterwards, and I gave him a copy of that. And I cried. I couldn't really say anything to him. I just said, thank you so much, and I hugged him. And we hugged for a long time, and I gave him that. And I wanted him to know how much his witness had meant to our family. And I just read a little bit here. Thomas Howard, who courageously journeyed beyond the boundaries of his fundamentalist Protestant roots to discover the glory of the Catholic Church, and in doing so broke through a hidden barrier, opening the door for thousands of us orphan souls to glimpse the light. But even more than that, he wrote, Evangelical Is Not Enough, and in so doing made it possible for me, my family, and countless friends and fellow evangelicals to find the Catholic Church, which from our birth had been deeply and darkly shrouded by grotesque caricatures and misinformation. His life and pages have enabled us to embark on a great love affair with the ancient church, which we have found to be forever young. For this great treasure, we owe Thomas Howard an eternal debt of gratitude.
Tom Howard was a part of your life too.
Yes, right. We were friends with Tom.
Yeah, during
Tom was
a very good
Anglican.
Yeah, mm-hmm. A very good friend of ours at Gordon College. He and his wife are the godparents of our first child. They're very dear friends of ours and very influential, really, in our conversion story. Because it was, I think, my exposure to Tom first of all that, well, not solely my exposure to Tom, but my exposure to Tom got me to think seriously about Catholicism. And when I first met him, he was struggling with the decision to become a Catholic. He'd been away for the summer, and he'd been reading all kinds of Catholic books, and he came back, and it was very much on his mind. He was really struggling with it. And I was part of a group of fellows, young fellows at Gordon College, who met with him on a monthly basis. We'd sit around and drink beer and smoke pipes and talk about C.S. Lewis, you know, pretend to be like the Inklings. But we struggled with him at that time. And I came to really appreciate his decision to go to the Roman Catholic Church.
Which was very difficult.
It was an extremely difficult one for him because it meant the loss of his job and the loss of his career. But I was not ready at that time yet to make the move myself.
Well, Tom, for viewers who might not be aware, Tom, of course, was an evangelical Episcopalian. And he taught at Gordon College in South Windham, Massachusetts. And so when I went up to Boston, Tom was close by. And I was introduced to him by a friend in Cincinnati named Ann Burley. Who was also a friend of the show. And somehow she introduced us and we got to know each other. And I had read his book, Evangelical Is Not Enough. But of course, I read it sensorially. You know, how could anyone do this who really loves the Lord and so forth?
Because his book, even from he wrote that first as an Episcopalian.
That's right.
Being a bit critical of evangelicals,
exactly.
And that's where you would have been.
Exactly. That's exactly right.
Were you open to his liturgical arguments?
I like the liturgical argument, but I couldn't go with him in the direction that he seemed to be going even in that book.
Yeah.
And the interesting thing about that book, as you say, is it was before his conversion, and it's, you know, similarly with the essay on the development of doctrine with Newman. Yeah. You know, he sort of wrote himself in this case into the church. So Tom and Loveless became good friends, and as this journey started, I asked Tom if he would be my sponsor, and we had many. My wife and I had many lovely dinners at his house in on the North Coast, North Shore of Massachusetts, and he was such a close confidant in those days because, like Tom, I knew that this was going to cost me my job, and of course when Tom converted, he had to leave Gordon College. It's an evangelical Christian college, and you know, Catholics can't teach there. And of course, I couldn't. I knew that if I did this, that I couldn't go back and teach. So I had to sort of start from scratch, from having my career completely mapped out. I was going to come back to Cincinnati, where I'm from, teach in the seminary where I taught before. And so Tom was a real source of moral support and encouragement as I faced some, frankly, economic realities that were going to arise by this decision that I was on my way to making.
I can say without any hesitation that with those three witnesses to how Tom influenced their life could be repeated over and over again, not only from so many other Journey Home programs, but from our experiences working with clergy and laity mm-hmm. on the journey in our work. Does anything they said echo your own experience of Tom helping you?
Oh, absolutely. I was especially taken with how much his work on the liturgy yep. touched them and helped them along. And when you think about it, if you, so forgive me for just slipping back into the early church for a moment, but St. Cyril of Jerusalem took the newly baptized and he brought them back to church after their baptism for a week to give them what he called the mystagogical lectures. That's what this stuff is that Tom wrote. Yeah. Basically, it's mystagogy, explaining the wonderful mysteries of the liturgy and the sacraments. And that was what really jumped out at me.
Yeah. The other thing that Ken Craycraft mentioned for Tom, which is a parallel to so much of the people we work with, is that when Tom became Catholic, he lost his job.
Yes, he did. Yeah. Yeah, he did. And in an amicable way, I thought Tom was wonderful about that. He was made it clear that he didn't force the hand of Gordon College. It was, right. They recognized that it was not going to work. So yeah. It was a mutuality there, but he paid a lot for
that. And it would have been hard for him to stay within himself.
That's right.
Yeah. Because of where he comes. Yeah. Okay, we're going to pause there, everybody. And we're going to come back with a couple of witnesses and some priests who point to Tom Howard. And then we'll talk a little bit more about his books and then some final visits with both Lovelace and Tom. Let's see a bit. Welcome back to this special edition of the Journey Home program. I'm Marcus Grodi, your normal host, and I'm joined by my co-host tonight, Monsignor Jeffrey Steenson. In this program, we're just taking some time to focus on our good friend Tom Howard, his wife Lovelace, and their impact on so many of our lives. As I mentioned earlier, a year ago, Tom passed, and so this is a way of thanking God for him and for his witness. What we want to go to now is a couple of real short clips of some priests who were on the journey home that talked about how Tom influenced them in their discernment of priesthood.
I started meeting regularly with Tom Howard. He had a Friday afternoon group that met in the upper room of a furniture shop, a guy who restored furniture. And so we'd go up in this upper room, fire stove, and that was my best seminary class. And it was really, though I didn't know it at the time, it was focused on truth and beauty and goodness. So we talked about art and dance and ballet. And of course, you know, Tom wrote the chants or the dance.
I was just thinking, so a lot of during that time,
those kinds of themes and just
book,
really,
great book.
Yeah, my horizons were expanded considerably. Of course, Tom is a Catholic encyclopedia and himself, so all these early church references and listening him, to him talk about the church and And he, of course, everyone can tell you he's not pushy in any way.
Right.
Just a very helpful resource.
So around the time I graduated, I actually called up Tom Howard. I basically called him up and asked him if he would be my friend, and he was so gracious and so warm.
Yeah.
And so I went to meet him in the early summer of 2003, and went to his home. He welcomed me, and we had a wonderful conversation. He began to answer questions and give me more reading that was sort of focused on the questions that I had, and the things that I the deficiencies that I'd begun to perceive about the Anglican claims, frankly. So I began to meet with Tom regularly, and we became very, very close friends. He became a real mentor for me.
Had Lovelace come into the church yet?
She had, yes.
Okay.
Yep. She had come into the church. I believe it was 10 years after he did, so that would have been in the mid-90s.
Yeah, they've both been on the journey home.
Yeah. So they became very, very dear friends and a great, great help to me. And so I was frequently going to meet with Tom. We would sit out in the yard, and we would sit in his study. It was a wonderful study with a handwritten letter from C.S. Lewis on the wall from when he was younger, and a graduate student himself, and just surrounded by all of his books. And we would just discuss things. He would answer my questions, and he really opened my mind to, I had studied economics, but he began to open my mind to great works of Catholic literature, things that he had been teaching. You know, he was teaching Tolkien long before the Lord of the Rings sort of craze.
Long before
craze.
Tolkien was cool.
So, right.
Those vignettes are not so much about, although I also know I'll get some emails from people about having the editor use Photoshop to take rid of my beard during that little segment here, but it is what it is. But those segments are not so much about Tom convincing them to become priests. But to me, the beauty of that is when we're working with somebody on the journey, two things. We have no idea what God might do with that person. We have no idea, right? Tom had no idea that these two men would one day be priests. And second of all, it points to the fact that when men and women make this big jump, they come with training and experiences and gifts, and how are they going to use those once they come into the church? And that's often a real struggle that we deal with.
Oh, for sure it is. And it sometimes takes real humility on the part of the people that have come in, because life is going to be a little bit different sometimes on the other side.
That's right.
You know.
We'd like to now take some time, keeping an eye on time here. I wanted to talk, Monsignor. And I want to tell the audience, if you like those little clips and you want to see more, go to EWTN.com and their YouTube channel and do a search, and you can watch the whole programs, as well as chnetwork.org, our YouTube channel. You can watch all the programs from those guests that we had as our clips for this program. I wanted to focus just a little bit, Monsignor. We don't want to make this a full bookmark program like Doug Keck would do. In fact, he probably has done bookmarks on Tom's books. But just to mention three books that, as I said in that last clip, I hope everybody goes out and buys these books by Tom Howard and reads them and then shares them, because he was truly a great author, in many ways unappreciated the way he should be. But the three books that he wrote that have the biggest influence on myself and on the work we do are Evangelical Is Not Enough, Lead Kindly Light, My Journey to Rome, and On Being Catholic. And if you will, the chronology of these books is Tom wrote Evangelical Is Not Enough to explain his transition from evangelicalism to the Anglican Church.
So 1984, I think.
1984, no anticipation he's going to become Catholic, but really explaining why he was moving in the directions of that Chicago call in terms of recognizing liturgy and ritual tradition and the value of that. And then he wrote Lead Kindly Light, his own journey to Rome. And that little phrase, Lead Kindly Light, points to somebody.
That's John Henry Newman's poem.
That's right. So there's that connection from Tom.
Yeah.
And so if you want to find out more about his story, and then his great collections of articles on being Catholic, all these are Ignatius Press books, which is more after you've come into the church, how do you be a Catholic? And he wrote a lot about that, and this book has been very helpful. I think it's helpful for Catholics that sometimes take for granted the beauties we have in the church, or maybe didn't quite notice yet, that sometimes it takes the eyes of a convert to see. Were these books important for you, Monsignor, in your journey?
Yes, they were. Obviously, that one, because we shared so much of the time together, going to church with Tom when we were Anglicans was a luminous experience, because he always commented about the liturgy. He always had something insightful to say about the worship that we'd just been a part of.
Yeah. And the chapter in Evangelicals Not Enough that had such an impact on both my wife Marilyn and myself is we had been evangelicals, and as a pastor for literally a little over 10 years in mostly Congregationalists or Presbyterian churches where our worship service was becoming much freer, mm-hmm. more contemporary, and every week I had to get up in front as the pastor and pray the big pastoral prayer before I preached. The struggle between which is most important, which is most effective, spontaneous, impromptu, unscripted prayers versus the scripted prayer. And as an evangelical, we kind of thumbed our noses at those people that were stuck with written prayers. But what he points out in this book in such a humorous way is that when you take a step back and you listen to independent, non-scripted, spontaneous prayer is just as liturgical. It's just different words, because you repeat the same words. You say, just and really, and I just really want you, Lord, and Lord God. And so there's always a liturgy to it. There's a ritual. And it awakened our hearts and minds to the reality of the ritual that essentially we were yearning for. Mm-hmm. And discovering through his writings the beauty of appreciating these great prayers that have been passed down to us through the ages.
On that first episode that you did with him, I made a note at the 45-minute mark. You asked him about repetitive prayer, and Tom had this marvelous reflection about praying the rosary, and he talked about how the purpose of repetitive prayer is not to do it mindlessly, but it's a way to help stay focused on what is essential and what is spiritual. Because otherwise, our bodies were trapped in this world, our minds, kind of wander. And I just thought it was a marvelous point he made at that point. I'm quite certain
that it was in reading that chapter while I was still on the journey that reminded me of something that is something we take for granted that is very true. And that is that God knows what we need.
Yes.
Before we utter a word.
That's it. Yeah, that's right.
The Lord's Prayer, for example, is a prayer in which we're expressing our gratitude to God that He's in control and He knows all that we need. And when we pray the things we pray, it's a way of affirming the things He wants to us affirm about Him, His holiness and our dependence on Him, providing our daily needs, our daily bread, daily Eucharist, recognizing that if He's going to forgive us, we need to forgive other people, and asking Him to protect us from the temptations and evils of life. I mean, there it is. There's a summary. And so, in essence, liturgical prayer is ultimately an expression of the recognition of grace. It's trusting that God's involved.
Marcus, also, those two books, Evangelicals Not Enough and Lead Kindly Light, both of these are Ignatius,
yes,
right?
Yes, right.
And these are the two books that have audio versions. And for a lot of people like an audio book, And you can get the audio of these. And what a wonderful way to drive to work. Instead of being angry at your neighbor on the road, on the freeway, you can be deep in deep. Oh, it's just, they're both excellent.
You just that. Did a nice yeah. segment of this EWTN's religious catalog there by promoting those two books. Okay. So, and so the reason we focus a little time on his books is because his books had such an influence on us. It has such an influence on the people we work with. We give these books away as and a part of our ministry to people mm-hmm. on the journey. And also, I think he's yet to be as appreciated as an author yet as I would like him to be. Yeah. He wrote another book on the four quartets, in which he, I'm not sure if that's the right title, but it's his doc, if you will. It's a commentary on T.S. Eliot's poem. And I tried to read the poem without it. And I can tell you, I didn't get very far. Tom Howard really brings it to life, and it shows one of the great gifts that he has in his ability to bring out the meat in that.
And can I ask you a question?
Depends. I can cut it out if I don't like the question.
What was Tom Howard's doctoral thesis at NYU?
Oh, I don't know, my friend.
Well, I've been looking, because he published it. Basically, he published a book, The Novels of Charles Williams, in 1991. And I've been on the lookout to try and get a copy of it. But so he wrote on Charles Williams. That was his dissertation, and that's when he went over to Oxford, and he met C.S. Lewis at the Kilns, and those wonderful reflections of that.
Maybe that's another reason why we when you read Tom and you know Tom, you really put him on the same page as C.S. Lewis and Tolkien, because someone like Williams tied them all together.
Williams. Yeah, because Charles Williams, what Tom had, I read a little bit of an essay Tom wrote on him, that Charles Williams not only participated in the Inkling discussions, but he also went and got the beer food and the drinks. So he was like Mary and Martha together, you know. It was a marvelous picture of him. But the other quote, because when he visited C.S. Lewis, in 1963, which you realize that was almost before Lewis passed away, because he died in that year, didn't he? But he quoted Lewis. Lewis told him, they were having a conversation about heaven. God is not going to force anyone into heaven.
Yeah.
Right. That was in conjunction with basically Charles Williams' idea of that God created us to be free. We have to choose.
All right. The second to last thing I want to do in this program is you're going to see some clips in a moment that several years ago, about three or four, it was the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation. Jim Anderson and I had a chance to go out to the East Coast. We went to my alma mater. We listened to a lot of Protestant speakers at the time, my old seminary professors, talk about the Reformation. But while we were out there, we had a great chance to visit with Tom and Lovelace in their home. I just wanted to show these pictures because I look back and what a gift that was, other than meeting him at EWTN, that when I think about meeting with them, the first picture will be a picture of Tom sitting in his chair in his study. And it was a wonderful time just conversing, talking about some of his books, talking about his love for Jesus Christ in the church. I mean, that was so clear from him. Then the next picture, you're going to see myself sitting with Tom and Lovelace in that study. And then in the end, as we were leaving and a parting, you'll see a picture of Jim Anderson standing in their doorway. I just lift this up to say what wonderful hospitality they showed, both in their home and open door to anyone who was on the journey.
Yeah.
Was that your...
That was my experience, too. Yeah. And Lovelace cooked splendidly.
Yeah, it was neat. This, you know, this is during Tom's last years when he was, you know, struggling a little bit, as we all do as we get older. I remember him digging out a shoebox full of some relics that he had. Remember those relics that he had from the Middle East?
Yeah, I faintly do.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember what they were, but they were something that he really loved to show, and it was really neat to have that. You know, and as we, to me, they're a model. You might see me on TV, I tend to be too much of an introvert. And to me, they are a model of hospitality, of think of all the ways that as he was on the journey, he would lead Bible studies, he would go into the evangelical world to meet with others, invite people into their home. And even as the new world of the internet and email came upon us, there he was answering people's questions. Mm-hmm. And as we looked at some of the earlier clips, there were at least two men who are now priests because of the hospitality and patience of Tom and Loveless. Yeah. Tom and Loveless. You know, I think, Monsignor, the audience may not know this, but one of your the things that you had a great privilege to do was to be the first ordinary of the Anglican Ordinariate. And you were that for 2 years? 3 years?
I did that for... Was it three? That started in 2012. Three and a half, I guess.
The reason I thought before we hear Tom's final clip here, Anglicans particularly, as you think of all the Anglicans, can you think about, did Tom and Loveless have a particular impact on Anglicans, Episcopalians, as they considered the church?
Oh, many. You've had one of your... guests on the journey home is Jürgen Lias, Father Jürgen Lias. Yeah. He was deeply part of Tom and Loveless's life. So many have been touched by him.
Okay. Yeah. And so as we do this special program in honor of Tom and Loveless, I'd like to close our program with a short clip from the very first program. Now, again, Monsignor, we didn't show that whole clip. This is the last thing. I do remember there was one question that I asked him, I think, in that program you had brought up, and that was the question as this issue of unity amongst Catholics and non-Catholics. And if I remember right, we don't have the clip, but I remember right, I think I asked him, right? I asked him, where is this unity found? Because the question often comes up for months. Here he was, you know, he made the choice to leave evangelicalism. Then he moved to Anglicanism and made a public statement about that in his book. And then he becomes Catholic. And in doing so, he loses a job and he loses an awful lot of friends along the journey. So, but it was all about the issue of unity.
And Marcus, I thought it'd be kind of neat to commemorate the first guest who ever phoned you on this. Her name was Lisa from Scarborough, Maine, at minute mark 36 in episode 1. And Lisa called and asked, where is the unity of the church to be found? And she was recognizing that even then, back then, the Catholic Church was, you know, there were many divisions and all that sort of thing. Yeah. And you and Tom beautifully talked, answered that question. I remember Tom saying that, the unity of the church is primarily, it's found in the Mass, because that's where we meet the risen Lord. And but it's also found in the magisterium, because that's what he left behind. And that's a really powerful moment in that.
I remember once, and I've got to be careful here because I'm not going to remember it perfectly, but I remember one time somebody asking Mother Angelica a question like this when this person was seeing all the scandal in the church and the divisions and even the division in Christendom and being distracted by goofy stuff happening up in front and asking Mother, what do you do? And her comment was, I don't remember it, I can't quote it, but something like, close your eyes, focus. Jesus knows what's going on. And I remember thinking about that, is that when you're in the Mass, for me, a comment in church, that when you're experiencing the Mass, you're experiencing the thread. All the way back to when Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 says, when you gather as a church, mm-hmm. that's what he's talking about.
Yeah.
He's talking about yeah. this thread of the unity. And magisterium, we might look now and we which bishop, which cardinal, which pope, you know, if you get caught up in all those questions. But the magisterium doesn't, it means the unity
yeah.
of the bishops with the successor of Peter, but not just in this moment, but that's in right. the history of the church.
Yeah, that's right. And that's a very important thing. Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
We can go on about that. We're grateful for Tom and his witness. We ask prayers for Tom and his family. And I'd like to close the program with the end of the first program, his last thoughts, as I ask him a question about following Jesus.
I've got to ask you one last question here because of our time. I think it's a very important question, and that is, in your journey to the Catholic Church and your journey of coming to the fullness of the appreciation of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, how has that helped you grow in your relationship with Jesus Christ, coming in your walk with Jesus Christ?
Well, it's immeasurable. It's absolutely immeasurable. I struggled. I was 50 when I became a Catholic, and I had struggled and struggled and struggled all my life to keep up, quotes, my relationship with the Lord. Mm-hmm. And the tools one has in that sector of Christendom are the Bible and one's own, as we called it, daily devotions. You most earnestly read the Scripture and you try to get something from it and you try to make your prayers authentic and meaningful and so on. But stepping into the ancient Catholic Church, I am lifted, I am born up, I am taken into this tremendous current. Every single one of the sacraments is Christocentric. Every single syllable of Catholic devotion, even Marian devotion, is ultimately Christocentric. I say a good bit of the office these days, for example. And I get out of bed in the morning anticipating being able to say morning prayer. Because it's there. The Psalms are there. The prayers are there. The Song of Zechariah is there for me. And then I include the Te Deum in my prayers. I wouldn't be able to spontaneously say, we praise thee, O God, we acknowledge thee to be the Lord. All the earth doth worship thee, the Father everlasting. Mm-hmm. It has immeasurably, shall I say, energized and nurtured and shored up and made steady this that you ask yeah. about, one's relationship with the Lord. I hardly think of it in those terms anymore. I think of myself as a Roman Catholic Christian. That's what I am.
I can't underline how much I'm appreciative of the words you just said.
Oh, yeah. It's just wonderful. You know, for Tom, every day was a feast day. You hear he was doing the Te Deum?
Yeah.
So it's magnificent to hear that.
I so appreciated those words because as a convert to the church, it still carries a long thread of my evangelical background. It's over time. Sometimes it's easy to forget and to appreciate the great gifts we received when we came into the church, and that was a great summary.
Yeah. And you know, wasn't that marvelous what he talked about, every syllable being Christocentric? Yeah. You know, for people that struggle with, for instance, the Marian dogmas, I mean, that's what Tom says here, that's the heart of the yeah. matter. Everything we say in praise of Mary is in praise of her Son.
Reminds me of the way Mother Angelica used to always begin her weekly program. Tonight we're going to talk about Jesus. That's what he's saying. Yeah. The center of this is our Lord Jesus. Monsignor, my friend, thank you.
Thank you so much, Marcus.
Thank
you. Love being with you.
Thank you. And thank you all for joining us on this special episode of The Journey Home. I do pray that revisiting Tom and his faith and his writings and his witness, both he and Lovelace, was an encouragement to you. God bless you. See you next week.